Yeah, there's some great songs that carry an amazing message. The Old Rugged Cross, Amazing Grace, different songs that we sing that really, if you really think about the message in the song, it can really touch your heart. It can really bless you. It can bring you joy. You know, when I was growing up in the church, I remember singing songs like Send the Light, Throw Out the Lifeline, Bringing in the Sheaves, Rescue the Perishing. You know what all those songs are about? Bringing in the Vault. We don't sing those songs anymore. Why don't we sing those songs anymore? Because the church has lost the focus on the mission, I believe. You know, there seems to be a theme here. This is not planned. I mean, God brought us forth in Sunday school, and, you know, we talk about those even in prayer requests that aren't good, that are out there drifting. And I'm going to get to it, but for their sermon this morning, you know what God gave me? Two words. And we'll get to that, but, and I had no idea where I was going with those two words. But we're going to find out. But first, I want to read you, this seems to be coming a habit with me, I want to read you the lyrics to a song. This part of Rescue the Perishing. Listen to this. Rescue the perishing, care for the dying, snatch them in pity from sin and the grave. Weep over the erring one, lift up the fallen, tell them of Jesus, the mighty to save. Rescue the perishing, care for the dying. Jesus is merciful, Jesus will save. There's a lot more to that song, but this is a call to the church. This is a call to the field, to the mission field, to reach out to those that are perishing. And there are many. We talked about it. We may be the only difference between eternity in heaven and an eternity in hell. And I think, you know, we've lost sight of the purpose of the church. And it comes up often, it came up a little bit this morning on Sunday school, the purpose of the lot of the church is to make people feel good. The purpose of the lot of the church is to teach people how to get along. A lot of it is to teach people how to make money. Various things. But that's not the purpose of the church. I know that we know. And I'm not saying I'm not included in this because I am. We know. Seldom do we do.
Right.
We know and we talk. But seldom do we take action. Mm-hmm. The nearer the return of Christ comes, the less hope the lost has. The nearer that day comes, the less time we have to try to reach them, to rescue the perishing, to care about those that are dying, that those that are hell-bound. In that lyric that I read you, it says, weep over them. Right. We don't have a heart for the lost.
That's right.
You know who we got a heart for? This guy. Yeah, it's easy to get all teary-eyed and weepy when I got a problem. Multitudes upon multitudes are going to hell. Maybe we need to do a little reality check on the reality of hell and what that means, and get a heart from the lost, and get a broken heart. We've gotten to a point in the church And again, I know this has already been kind of mentioned, but this is where God has taken me. We've gotten to a point in the church where we think, well, I never received the call. I'm not a missionary. I'm not a preacher. I'm not this. I'm not that. So what the church has come around to, what we do nowadays, the way we handle this is, we write out a check to World Missions and we've done our part. We put money in the offering when the missionary comes to our church to speak. So we've done our part. We pay the pastor's salary, so we've done our part. Whatever it is, we let ourselves off the hook by saying, I've done my part to get the word to the lost. You can't show me in here where he ever said, go ye into all the world and preach the gospel unless you give money to somebody else to do it. You should do both. You should support good missions. You should support things like that if you can. If God has blessed you and enabled you to do that, you should do that. But that doesn't let you off the hook. Like I said, we say to ourselves, you know, either that's not my job, that's not what I was called to do, or whatever. Or we say, I can't. I'm not equipped. I'm not capable. I'm not this. I'm not that. And that's kind of what where God is leading me to. And the two words that God gave me were, I am. Read a couple of verses. It's going to be in the book of Exodus, chapter 3, and verse 14. Exodus 3, verse 14. I'm sure you all know, this is at the point where Moses saw the burning bush in the desert that wasn't consumed. So he went to see what that was all about, and there God spoke to him from the bush. That's what's happening here. And he had said to Moses that he would go into Egypt and bring out the children of Israel. And we'll get here to verse 14. Moses had asked God, who shall I tell them sent me here to do this? Verse 14, and God said unto Moses, I am that I am. And he said, thus shalt thou say unto the children of Israel, I am, has sent me unto you. I want to jump over to chapter 4, verse 10. And Moses said unto the Lord, O my Lord, I am not eloquent, neither heretofore nor since thou hast spoken unto thy servant, but I am slow of speech and of a slow tongue. And the Lord said unto him, who hath made man's mouth? Or who maketh the dumb, or deaf, or the seeing, or the blind? Have not I the Lord? Now therefore go, and I will be with thy mouth, and teach thee what thou shalt say. And we're going to stop reading right there. And I'm going to try to give you what God has given me. It may not be much. I'm not even exactly sure where we're going to go, but... listen, God appeared to Moses and he told Moses, I'm going to send you down to Egypt. You're going to do an amazing thing. You're going to go to Pharaoh, the ruler, the big guy, and you're going to tell him, you're going to let all these millions of slaves go. And I'm going to go with you down there and going to bring them out of there and deliver them from captivity. And Moses said to him, I can't do that. How many of us have ever said, I can't do that? Mm-hmm. You know what he said? I'm not able. Here, and Moses said unto the Lord, oh my Lord, I am not eloquent. What did he say? I can't talk good. What can I say? I'm not convincing. I don't have a good argument. I don't know how to put it into proper terms. Whatever it was that he was talking about. But he said, I am not eloquent. You know what God said? It's yours.
I am.
You know what God said to you? Whenever you say I can't, whenever you say I'm not able, whenever you say I don't have that ability, whenever you say that, you know, there's no way, God, look, I know Greg keeps hollering about we're supposed to go out and witness, and Greg keeps saying that's what the Bible tells us to do, and Greg keeps saying, but God, you didn't gift me to do that. God, you didn't enable me to do that. I'm not able to do that. And God says the same thing to you that he said to Moses, I am, and I will go with you. I will speak. I will give you the word. I will use your mouth. I will use whatever it is that I have given you. Am I not the one who has made all this? Am I not the one who has created all this? Am I not the one who is able to do all this? And that is what God is trying to tell us today. Just get up and go. Moses had his doubts. He didn't think he could do it. He didn't think he was capable. He didn't think he had the ability to do this. Moses had his doubt, but God said to him, I am able, and I am going to go with you. Well, what did he say? He said, oh my Lord, I can't do this, in my word. But what did God say? Now therefore go, and I will be with thy mouth, and teach thee what thou shalt say. That's what God is saying to us today. You just go, and I'll handle the rest. That's basically what he's saying. You just go, and I'll handle the rest. How many of you want God mad at you? How many of you think God gets mad at you? How many of you think God gets mad at you because we are not doing what he has called us to do? He got mad at Moses. Listen, if we go down, verse 13, and he said, O my Lord, send I pray thee by the hand of him whom thou said. Verse 14, and the anger of the Lord was kindled against Moses. God got mad at Moses because, you know why? Why did God get mad at Moses?
Because he was refusing.
What was that?
He was refusing to do what God asked.
That's part of it. That's not the real reason.
He was whining. He's
making up excuses.
Yeah, that's all part of it. But the bottom line is, he doubted God. Mm-hmm. So do you. Mm-hmm. When you say, I can't, you doubt God. I can do what?
All things through Christ, which strengthens you.
Because Christ said, I am. Christ said, I am the way. Christ said, without me, you can do nothing. But with God,
all things are possible.
And when we say, I can't, we doubt God. We, and it may not be intentional, and we may not form the thought or whatever, but listen, when we say that, basically what we're saying is, I don't believe you. Listen, I know me. I know I can't do that. I know I don't have the ability. I know I'm not able. When I'm saying all that, I'm saying, God's not powerful enough. God's not God enough. God's not God enough to be able to use whom he chooses to use. To be able to work through whomever he chooses to work through. Listen, Moses said, I can't do it. Moses said, I am not able. God said, I am. That's the thing. He will go with you. He will speak through you. He doesn't want you to come up with the ideas. He doesn't want you to come up with a good argument. He doesn't want you to come up with everything that is just so right down the line, nobody can refute it. What he wants you to do is be obedient. What he wants you to do is open your mouth and let him fill it. What he wants you to do is believe him. What he wants you to do is trust him. I'm telling you right now, this little group sitting right here, and I know you've heard this before, I've said similar before, and it goes in one ear and it goes out the other, and by tomorrow we have forgotten all about it, but this little group right here could turn your county upside down. With God, through God, allowing God to work through us. What kind of a God do you really have? Think about that. The kind of God you really have is defined by how you act, by what you do or don't do. That defines who your God is. When I say I can't, what I'm saying is, I don't have a very big God. I don't have a very powerful God. Listen, I know within me, within my flesh, I can't. But I know if I am yielded to God, the scriptures that we just talked about, I can do all things through Christ. With God, all things are possible. Listen, you know all these things. And why God's given them to me? Somebody knows, because somebody needs it. David beat a giant with what? A piece of leather and a rock. Think about it. A piece of leather and a rock. He didn't only beat Goliath. You know what he did? He put the whole Philistine army on the run. One boy with a piece of leather and a rock. You know what Samson did with a bone? Moses with a stick. What did? All the things that God has used, and how often have you heard this verse? God has chosen the weak things of the world. That's me, I'm telling you. Why has he chosen the weak things? The base things. The things that are looked down on. The people that don't have huge abilities and huge names. And why has he chosen them?
So we can trust them.
So that he can work. Because when you think you're all that, when you think you're something, you get in God's way. But you know what else? When you think you can't, you get in God's way. We have to understand, and God used to give me this a lot, and I don't think I've said it that much lately, but it's not about us.
Right.
It's about God.
Right.
You are a vessel.
Right.
Nothing but a vessel for God to work through. And we need to present ourselves in that manner. And if we would really present ourselves in that manner, if we would be like the old prophet, that when he heard God say, "Who shall we send and who will go for us?" If we would be like the prophet and say, "Here am I, send me," fully trusting God, we could do what that prophet did. Through God. Everybody knows the account of Gideon, right? How did Gideon's 300 defeat a combined army from two nations? How?
They relied on God.
It was through God, but what did they actually do? What did they physically do? It was what God told them to do.
Busted the armor, blew the trumpet.
And what was inside the pitcher?
A candle.
A light. We're just a vessel. Just like that pitcher was just a vessel. When that pitcher that they busted was taken out of the way, the light shone forth. If we take this out of the way and let Christ shine forth, Christ will work through us to accomplish the things that he wants to get accomplished, to reach the people, to rescue the perishing, to pull them in, to bring in the sheaves, all those things. He will work through us to do that. And I know it's become a theme here this morning, but this is what God wants me to know and what he wants me to tell you. It's time that we get out there and start doing the work. It's time that we get out there and start being a witness. It's time that we get out there. How many of you can say, as that old song said, "I threw out the lifeline. There was someone sinking fast. They were on their way to hell, but I threw out the lifeline." How many of you can say we did that last week, or the week before, or last month, or the month before? That's what we're supposed to be doing. That's what this is all about. It's not about having church meetings. It's not about having a nice church building. It's not about having an offering. It's about reaching the lost. And that's what we're not doing. I know that we have got good-hearted people here and people who care. But I'm telling you, somewhere along the line, we have lost that heart for the lost. We have lost that drive, that we are supposed to have to get out there and to bring them in for Christ. We have lost that, and we need to get that back, and we need to get out there and start really like the lyrics to that song said, start really getting a heart for the Lord and weeping over them and trying to pull them out of the flames and bring them to Christ. I'm going to ask you a question.